Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another edition of Centering on Peace. My name is John Hoskyns-Abrahall. Centering on Peace is brought to you on the second Tuesday of every month by the Berks Peace Community. We're a long-time peace community here in Berks County. Some people take us back to the 50s, but we certainly know that we were here during the Vietnam War and all the succeeding wars that have gone on and on right up to the present day. Tomorrow it should be noted that it is September the 11th, and of course that's a date that is going to be huge, has been huge, ever since that fateful day in 2001, with endless wars ever since then. And on a more cheerful note, though, or more promising note in terms of organizing peace activities, climate justice activities, is the Sunrise Movement's climate strike, which is going to be celebrated here in Reading, PA, in the City Park, from 12 to 2 on September the 20th. And then, of course, the big climate summit is in at the UN on September the 23rd. Let's hope we can see some action there. If we've got to hope, it's certainly the Sunrise Movement. And finally, I'd like to say that, as always, the Berks Peace Community does our vigil every Friday afternoon at 5 p.m. on the Penn Street Bridge. You're welcome to join us. In fact, we'd be delighted if you did, to show up at the Penn Street Bridge at 5 p.m.-ish. But tonight, I want to say how excited I am to be able to introduce you to George Lakey. George is one of the seminal figures in the peace movement and has been for 5 decades, I guess, at least. So George, thank you very much for doing this program with us and for giving us the benefit of your great experience in organizing and being a master strategist in terms of how movements can improve their way of doing their business and also in terms of actual successes. Speaking as a peace person in Berks County, I must say that the last few years since the start of the Second Iraq War, Second Gulf War, I guess we should say, when our meetings were packed on the first Monday of every month, the peace movement here has dwindled. And obviously those of us who are still doing it bear some of the blame for not being able to grow it. So I'm hoping that those of you in a similar position as organizers in Berks County will learn a lot from George. So George, welcome again to Centering on Peace. Thanks for being here.
Thank you, John. Thank you for inviting me.
Perhaps
Go ahead.
Perhaps you could tell us about your journey. Don't tell us the whole journey, because it's been a very long and distinguished journey. But I heard you on a show say that you grew up in rural Pennsylvania, and the very first thing you did was to give a sermon. Perhaps you could start there.
Yes. I was brought up north of Berks County, in Northampton County, small town in rural Pennsylvania. And yes, at age 12, I was invited to give a sermon at my church because the elders in my church thought that it might be, noticing how religious a boy I was, they thought maybe I had the makings for a child preacher, because in those days, there was such a thing as child preachers who would run around and speak, and everybody thought that was, you know, cute and maybe sometimes moving. Anyway, I was asked to take the pulpit, and basically for what was a tryout. I didn't understand all this very well, except that I thought, well, if that's a big responsibility, I'd better pray hard to find out what it is that God wants me to say when I get the pulpit. And so I did pray hard, and the result was a sermon in which I preached that it was God's will that there be racial equality. And that was 1949 in rural Pennsylvania.
Wow.
That was not a sermon anyone wanted to hear in my church. And so, in fact, I blew my audition. It was very much, the word from the elders basically was, don't call us, we'll call you.
Right.
That was my one day preaching career. It's been a glorious life being committed to peace because that didn't discourage me. It got me wondering, and it certainly knocked me down a level or two in terms of what's really fundamental for me. Is this an ego trip? You know, is this an effort to shine? Or am I really trying to witness to the truth as I understand it? And, of course, that's a good question for anybody to ask, and it was, yes, a very good question for me to ask.
I just want to talk to the people in the control room. Coming over the monitor here, the sound, George's sound in particular, is not, is it clear there? It's clear, it's, okay, good. Sorry to interrupt you, George. Anyway,
I would like to say that a very positive memory I have from Berks County is that in 1984, when I was leading a statewide peace campaign called the Jobs with Peace Campaign.
Oh, yeah.
We were running referenda in a number of counties around Pennsylvania, including Berks County. And so I had the opportunity to come to Berks County quite a lot and see how the campaign was going. And I was tickled as anything when the majority of those who voted on the referendum, a big majority, something like 68% or something like that, voted yes on the Jobs with Peace question, which was, should we take money out of the military budget and put it into civilian needs?
Yes, a question that still is left hanging out there because it just is not brought up by either party, the centrality of the military budget and the, you know, it's over 50% of GDP is spent on the military in one form or another. And of course, we're not really talking about the personnel, we're talking about the weapons systems. Those are the things that cost the money, and those are the things that, you know, against a, God forbid, let's say a guerrilla nuclear attack, a backpack bomb in New York, your aircraft carrier is not going to do you a lot of good. So,
but they're so valuable for profits.
Yes.
High-tech military is the biggest opportunity for profit that there is in this country. So you know, from their point of view, that is the point of view of the economic elite that pretty much runs our country, the larger the military, the better, because the larger the profits can be gained as a result.
Yeah. My guest tonight, for you, those of you viewing either on television or or streaming, is George Lakey, kind of an iconic figure in the peace movement, and a longtime theoretician of nonviolence, a Quaker, and having started, as we heard, with the 12-year-old sermon in rural Pennsylvania, he went on to ban the bomb, and then I guess the civil rights movement was the next major, had the most effect on your life, the next major effect on your life.
Yes, it definitely did, because I got to the place where I could actually participate. The mass movement developed in nearby Chester, Pennsylvania, and I went out there. That was the first time I got arrested and experienced the whole, dynamic of being inside a movement, taking high risk, and experiencing that, getting beaten up by cops in that situation. A lot of important experiences for people to have if they want to learn about how they, as individuals, can handle themselves in situations of danger and risk on behalf of their ideals. And the civil rights movement was an amazing place to learn that, as well as to learn a tremendous lot about strategy when you are, as they were, a small minority, what 10% of the population was African American, up against a majority that didn't want them to have their civil rights, and an economic elite that certainly didn't want them to have their civil rights, and neither major party wanted to touch the civil rights movement with a 10-foot pole. And so they were, and anyone looking at that situation objectively would say, well, why are you even bothering? This is a hopeless cause.
Right.
And of course, they were able to develop a strategy, which was basically based on nonviolent direct action campaigning, that was successful and won victory after victory after victory. And as we know, victories feed on victories. You know, if you can win, as they did, the Montgomery bus boycott in 1955, then from there on, it was, oh, we know we are winners, even in such a hardcore state as Alabama, we can win. So let's keep figuring out. And that meant that even though they lost some campaigns also, they understood that nonviolent direct action campaigning is the way to win an objective, even if you're in a minority situation, even when the parties don't bless your efforts. Nevertheless, you can still force a victory under certain circumstances. And that's a tremendous lesson for all of us right. to learn.
So the lesson to be learned is, don't fight back, I guess.
No. The lesson to be learned is go on the offensive with nonviolent direct action with a very specific demand that right. you know when you've achieved it. You know, it's not peace now
yes.
or racial fellowship now. You know, it's
right.
very specific demand, and you find the pressure points on the part of the opponent that will enable the opponent or pressure the opponent against their will to concede the demand to you. That's the basics of nonviolent direct action right. campaigning. And right. the not hitting back is just a part of the discipline. Every form of combat has discipline, right?
Yes.
Soldiers who go into the military have to take boot camp, you know, they have to go through basic training and so on to learn what are the disciplines that are involved with being a good military soldier. And in the same way, we who have enlisted in the peace effort can understand, of course, there's a discipline. Of course, there are things we can do and we should not do. And we simply learn those disciplines as part of being able to be successful and to be winners.
And it works, I guess, because eventually the public sees the blows you're taking, and they empathize, and they pick up the underdog, and eventually the ball gets rolling. And that's how you topple a majority.
That's right.
Yeah, which is painful when you're on the receiving end of the blows, I have no doubt.
Yes.
Yeah. I just want to tell our viewers that the number in the studio is 610-378-0426, 610-378-0426. And my guest tonight is George Lakey. And we're going to get to the question of migration right now, because that's how I've labeled this, although George could tell us a thing or two about many, many different aspects of organizing. But it does seem to me, George, that migration is the biggest, well, disregarding the existential threat of climate change and nuclear bombs, but migration is where the social issues come in the sense that, people who are our age don't recognize the places they grew up in. And that change is so dramatic. And in certain areas where, like in Hungary and Poland and Germany and you name it, in Europe and here in the US, the influx of people fleeing extreme poverty, danger of all kinds, political persecution is horrific, and yet we're terrified of them. And I guess the reason is because nobody, barring a few people like yourself, has explained why it is that that migration and diversity in a community, as diversity in a forest, can actually build the society, and societies stagnate when they're monocultures. Everybody looks the same and everybody talks the same. There's no life. And I think that's a huge mistake, and perhaps you could talk to that with greater depth.
Right. Well, whenever I try to find a way forward that with a big challenge, I always look for people who seem to have made some progress on it. In the professions, it's a matter of, you know, a matter of course. Professionals are always looking for best practices, they call it.
Yeah.
Doctors and dentists want best practices, and so do lawyers, and so do business people, and everybody wants the best practices when they're up against some problem. Who has dealt with this successfully, right?
Yeah.
So the same can apply to immigration. We can ask ourselves, oh, okay, so if we're challenged by immigration in this country, then let's look around and see who's been successful, who are doing the best practices. And in my observation, the best practice has been adopted by the Scandinavian countries, which is very handy because they ancestrally have been largely white people and a lot of Protestants over there and so on. They're very easy case for us to emulate because culturally they're so similar to us. If it were Indonesia or someplace like that, Indonesia's had some interesting immigration issues. But it's very nice if the best practice happens to be practiced by people who look a lot like those in this country who are most challenged. And in that case, it's white people who are the most challenged by immigration. Okay, so what is they're doing well? And I really emphasize this in the book that I wrote called Viking Economics, which is about Norway, Sweden, Denmark, and Iceland.
I just happen to have a copy right here.
Ah, there we go. There we go. It's been such a popular book.
It's very, very interesting.
The London Times made it a book of the week when it came out. Time Magazine wrote about it, and Bloomberg.com wrote about it. It's had quite a wonderful run, and it's still in bookstores. And the thing that I discovered through a lot of interviewing is that the Swedes and Norwegians, who especially are on it, on this case, and especially like to watch each other's practices because they also believe in best practices, and they don't do things identically, so they're always interested. Well, what are you doing on that? What are you doing on that? So, for example, Sweden took a larger number of immigrants from the exodus a couple of years ago. I remember when so many were coming from Syria and other parts of the Middle East. Sweden took more per capita than any other country in Europe. There were so many people, in fact, coming through the gates that there were people sleeping on desks of social workers and the people in the immigration department. I mean, it was just, they actually overdid it in a sense by opening the gates so wide. But they did that because there was this humanitarian crisis. And so they wanted to be very welcoming. Okay, so the Swedes are in some ways the champions of the peoples who decided immigration. Why? Well, the approach in general in social policy in Scandinavia is to believe that what is good to do, that is ethically fair and just to do, is also in our best interest to do. That is, they don't see it, they don't expect an opposition to exist between what's practical and what's moral. They expect practicality and morality to go together. That's what they expect. And so with regard to immigration, what is practical for the Swedes about accepting so many people in that way? What's practical is that they notice what their demography is. Their demography is that they're going to have a lot of old Swedes soon who are going to need extra medical care because they're old, more likely to get ill. They're going to need more of the caring kinds of things than Swedes nowadays need, because the young Swedes are not reproducing at the old rates. And so there's a need for young people, and an influx of immigrants works just fine. They'll be able to support the economy, which is one of the best economies in the world. And Sweden is very used to having a very abundant economy, very used to free higher education, very used to excellent medical care available for all, and so on and so on. And they want to keep those high standards, which make the United States look like a bedraggled third world country by comparison. Okay, so Sweden understood that it was in its best national interest to invite all this immigration. And they also thought it's our national character to be welcoming and to be hospitable. However, I found out last time I was over there interviewing in Norway that the Swedes were looking over the shoulders of the Norwegians and saying, oh, there's something very smart you do that we don't do and that would improve our practice. What's that? Mm-hmm. Well, I made the acquaintance while I was in Norway. I married into Norway. I have a family there. I spend a lot of time running back and forth. And I made the acquaintance of a guy from Africa. And I said, Gerald, would you be willing to sit down with me and tell me your story about what it was like for you as an immigrant? And he said, and then I later checked with the immigration people, and they said, yes, this is a typical story. He said, well, when I came into the country, I was sat down with a government worker. The government worker said, okay, we offer you a deal. Here's the deal. We will pay you a living wage for a year, and we will help you find a place to stay. In return, we expect you to take language lessons so that you can speak our language. We expect you to take job training, so because maybe you're an amazing something or other in your own country, but we don't hire people to do that here. So you need to take job training in a job, in a skill set that you're interested in that we actually need people for. You need to agree to go to the place where we assign you. In other words, it's not just go anywhere. We will put you someplace in Norway. Now, the government worker said, what I have to warn you about is that you might be placed in a remote fishing village along a western fjord where there's nobody of color anywhere near you. And the year you spend there might be the loneliest year of your life. Mm-hmm. So keep that in mind, but that is part of the deal. Okay, it might be that our language is so very different from yours that you need extra time. We can renegotiate, and we can give you extra time, continuing to pay you your wage and continuing to support your life. And so that's the deal, says the government worker. Take it or leave it. What do you think? Maybe you can get a better deal in some other country. Gerald says, hey, that's the best deal I've heard. I'll take it. Mm-hmm. So I said, so what was it like to be in, where were you? Right. And he said, they were right. I was put in a remote valley, nobody else of color anywhere near. And it was the loneliest year of my life. But he said, I worked very hard on my Norwegian. I worked very hard on job skills and education and so on. And at the end of the year, I did what I was permitted to do, which was to go back to Oslo, where there are other people like me, And so... And I said, so what is it like now? He said, oh, gosh, well, I fell in love with an ethnic Norwegian. We've started a family. We have a baby. We go to church together. I'm in the church band. We have a great life. It's incredible. I can't imagine being able to have the life, in my own country, given the circumstances there that I have here. Okay, so that is a feature of the Norwegian approach to immigration. They offer all the immigrants the same deal. And it's a feature that is being picked up now by the Swedes, who made the mistake of allowing immigrants to go wherever they wanted to. They tended to congregate in what became ghettos, really, where people all spoke the same language, right? Well, that's more comfortable, right? Mm-hmm. It also keeps them from needing to learn Swedish and needing to pick up so on and so on, right? So right. They don't assimilate. They just hang together. Well, after a while, idle hands do mischief make and so on and so on. Gangs form. There are always racketeers around wanting to immigrate, wanting to bring in drugs and so on. They're the obvious people to try to market to and so on and so on. And all kinds of problems compound themselves because the Swedes were doing the wrong policy and the Norwegians were doing the correct policy. But anyway, my challenge to Americans is, why wouldn't we want to learn from best practices elsewhere and do what works for them. We also have a demographic challenge. We have a Midwest full of small towns that are emptying out.
Yeah.
We have rural hospitals closing because there aren't enough people there to keep the hospitals open. We have schools closing because there aren't enough children. We have a population need. We need immigrants. The appeal to self-interest is, of course, extremely important and definitely buying into human nature, which is that we as human beings are self-interested. That needs to be an understanding that the pro-immigration forces in the U.S. use. We aren't using that very well, as far as I know.
Yeah.
They use that in Norway. They use that in Sweden. They say, look, our country's economic future, and you love the economy, we know you do, our country's economic future will be better if we accept immigration. We just need to handle it correctly, and feedback is welcome.
Yeah, that's great. What it brings to my mind, though, is that I think in this country, we are under the misapprehension that it's a zero-sum game. If right. African Americans get rights, then that means that whites are having theirs reduced. And it seems to me a fundamental lesson that no, the expanse of freedom is the expanse of freedom and works to everybody's benefit. And the same way with immigration. I mean, I think you're dead right in pointing out there are certain practicalities that make better policy. But in general, all this business about immigrants in this country leeching off hospital care and taxes and this and that, and when in fact we know that they contribute to the society, we know that they don't, they commit crimes at a lower rate, etc., etc. They are obviously a net benefit to the economy. I mean, you just look around at all sorts of professions that are really hurting when and if, which we assume it will be, refugee numbers decrease. In which case, a lot of awful lot of professions, businesses will, particularly small businesses, will feel it dramatically. But I get it. I get that it's hard to make friends with someone who doesn't know anything about Berks County or wherever, and you don't know anything about where they are. And we just have to somehow bridge that gap.
Well, are immigrants to Reading going to language class? So they speak English. And are they going to culture classes in which they learn about Berks County and its German-American history and its socialist history and so on and so on?
Yeah.
That are the schools and educational institutions in Berks County addressing the very legitimate questions that immigrants have about the place that they're moving to and wanting to rear their children in? My guess is that there's nothing like what are the best practices in Scandinavia. Then.
Yeah.
And there are good reasons for that. I don't know your situation, except if it's anything like Philadelphia, you don't have an abundance of money to put into taking care with immigrants. Well, why is that, I wonder? So the other thing we can learn from the Scandinavian countries is how is it that they could actually put the enormous upfront investment? I mean, think of it, paying somebody a year's salary in order to learn the language and so on and so on, right? That's a big upfront investment. Well, it's not unheard of for you to put a big investment into somebody if you expect returns, right? But you still need to get the money to be able to put the investment. Well, the Scandinavian countries tax the rich enormously, and therefore have the money to do this.
Right.
And so we have to do the same in order to be able to afford it. Just like the Green New Deal, if we want to do the Green New Deal, we have to tax people in order to get, not working class people, certainly not, the billionaires. And the millionaires need to fork over the money in order to be able to do what's good for the society. And that brings us back to the question of social change. How do you force change when the country is run by an oligarchy, which wants even more tax evasion?
Yeah, right, right. Let me reintroduce you, George. My guest tonight is George Lakey, a longtime peace activist, organizer, strategist, author, article writer, you name it. He's done an awful lot of it. And we'd certainly welcome your questions or comments in the studio at 610-378-0426. But I thought maybe we could go back a bit now, because in reading your book, I read that it wasn't as if the Viking economic explosion grew out of thin air. In fact, it was a situation much like ours, as I understand it. In the early part of the 20th century, there were lots of peasants and a few rich people, and suddenly, can you explain how that changeover to a kind of, well, you wouldn't call it a socialist economy, you'd call it an economy with social concerns that takes care of itself, that doesn't leave a huge inequality gap, which we know carries with it a high risk of conflict always.
Right. Yeah, well, as you say, 100 years ago, those countries were incredibly unequal. Now they're at the top of the line in terms of how much equality they have, but then hugely unequal like we are, and they had tremendous poverty as we do. And so they were really up against it. In fact, that's why so many Norwegians came to the U.S. and Swedes came to the U.S. and Finns. You know, there was this mass migration to the U.S. and Canada and other lands of opportunity because those countries were in such bad shape. And now they're the top of the heap. So what made the difference was people ganged up on the economic elite. And, you know, here it's popular to say the 1%. Well, yeah. It was the 1% there too. And ganging up on the tiny minority, it's not really all that hard to do. So, yeah. But you do need a certain technology to be able to do it well. And they created the technology that then the civil rights movement later used without knowing the Scandinavians did it. And that is the technology called nonviolent direct action campaigning. Right. So workers campaigned through the use of the strike largely, but also boycotts. Non-workers, farmers used boycotts and other means. Lots of demonstrations in the streets, takeovers, occupations, that kind of thing. So they were using nonviolent direct action means in order. You must remember, Scandinavia is right next to Russia, right?
Yeah.
So they had seen close up the Russian Revolution, which was based on armed struggle, and the civil war that then followed. They didn't want to go through that.
Yeah.
So they had good reason to say, we're not going to just follow the path. Most of the leadership, actually, of those people's movements in Scandinavia were Marxists. Most of the leaders were. But they said, even though our fellow Marxists in Russia, have pulled off a revolution, look at the price they paid. Mm-hmm. And we're not going to do that. So instead, we will do a nonviolent equivalent. We will do revolution, but we'll do a nonviolent equivalent in which we use the power of non-cooperation instead of the power of armed force. And so that's exactly what they did. And they threw out the 1%. And the 1% did not take it lying down. They, of course, were in charge of their governments. They were in charge of the military. Sweden, for example, called out the military over and over to suppress the workers' movements. In fact, they went so far in 1931 as to massacre workers who were on strike and were demonstrating, unarmed demonstrators, and there was a massacre. And the Swedish labor movement was so smart. Instead of taking that moment to say, we're getting killed on the streets, so maybe we better switch to violence now or something like that, which some movements do, they said, now we up the ante. We escalate by calling on Sweden as a whole to non-cooperate. And that's what happened, a general strike.
Uh-huh.
And the government fell. And that was it. The Social Democrats, who were democratic socialists, the democratic socialists took over the government because the government fell, and they were in power for 35, 40 years. and instituted the what we call now, what economists call the economic, the Nordic economic model.
Mm-hmm. And contrary to what the 1% would say here, Volvo survives fine. IKEA is just dandy. I mean, you can make money in the Nordic countries.
Yes, but enormously regulated.
Enormously regulated, right.
Hugely regulated. That was the deal that was made. The deal was, we will allow you to retain ownership of your enterprises.
Okay.
But you have to know, we're going to tax you like crazy, and we're going to regulate you like crazy. And in the case of Norway, which was the most leftist of the Scandinavian countries, the most Marxist, most heavily Marxist, they decided that they would actually take ownership, partial ownership, of a number of the corporations. So, for example, they own controlling interests of all the major corporations in Norway. And when oil was discovered in the North Sea, they set up a 100% public institution, a publicly owned corporation, in order to exploit the oil. So I call them socialists. I call them democratic socialists because they love democracy so much. They're far more democratic than here. Mm-hmm. And individuals have far more individual freedom there than here. So
in what
they
sense?
Really love that aspect of what we call democracy, and I wish we had it. They love it so much they actually have it. And they have the individual freedom that we would love to have. But they also are able to have it and keep it because they have taken over the what you might call the what C. Wright Mills, the sociologist, called the commanding heights of the economy.
Right.
In other words, the direction of the economy is set by the people, not by the entrepreneurs, not by the owners. The direction of the economy is set by the people. So yes, there's private ownership, but it's private ownership for some concerns in the context of overall people's control. And it's that democracy that really works.
And they always score highly on the happiness index, so obviously people like it.
Right at the top.
When you say individual freedom is magnified, can you give us some examples of that? That we don't have here?
Sure. So, okay, there you are, Norwegian 15-year-old, and you finished the compulsory part of your education, right? Well, you have choices. You can do vocational of some kind. You could apprentice yourself in some kind of program if you like learning outside the classroom, or you can do classroom work on the vocational line, or you could take the academic line. And if you've taken the vocational line, though, they build in enough academic courses so that if you change your mind, because teenagers have been known to change their minds, they, you know, there I am at 18. Oh my gosh, you know, I wish I could go to university after all. No problem. All you need is one more semester's work and you can go right into university. And then university, of course, is free.
Right.
There's a degree of freedom that we don't exist. I went to University of Oslo for free. $13 I paid for matriculation fee. That was it. And, of course, medical school is free. Of course. Mm-hmm. From their point of view, why on earth would you charge people to go to medical school? We need doctors. So, of course, it's free. Law school is free. Ballet school is free. Art school is free. All of those higher education things are free. Of course, they say. Affordable. Okay, so there you are no longer a teenager. Now you're a young woman who has a baby and who wants to continue her developing her career. Affordable childcare, absolutely. Very often, if it's a larger concern where you go to work, there's a nursery there. You get up to 4 hours of paid work time to nurse your baby on the job. There's parental leave of up to different Scandinavian countries have 11 months, 12 months, 13 months, 14 months paid. You're paid to be a parent. One of you stays home.
And they
required that men do it if they want to get into the deal. So there's just all these ways in which people have permission. There's universal pension, which means that, at, let's say you're that 45-year-old, now we're moving up the age scale, right?
Yeah.
You're this 45-year-old who has the best entrepreneurial idea you've ever had. Oh my gosh, this is a great thing. I will make it in my garage. I can. But on the other hand, I have to keep my job because I, no, you don't have to keep your job because you can get grants to support you to do the entrepreneurial development that you want to do because they love entrepreneurs. They consider it a kind of talent, like art, sculpture. They support musicians. Of course, they would want to support entrepreneurs. But there you are, 45, saying, but in order to execute this idea, I need to go to engineering school. I've never been to engineering school. Do it. It's free.
Yeah.
What's your problem, right? Okay, so there you are in Denmark, and you're saying, you know what? I wake up Monday morning, and I don't want to go to work anymore. Somehow, at age 50, I've lost the zest. I don't like my job. I liked it when I was 30, but I don't now. What's the Danish solution? Quit. It's important that you quit. If you want to quit, you should quit. Reskill yourself. Go to a school where you can develop new skills, whatever suits your fancy. It's free. Why would you hold back? And then re-enter the labor market doing this new thing. You'll add years to your life. Yeah, but I don't know. Can I add years to my life? Is that a good idea? Why not? There's pension, free pension waiting for you at the end of your life. Now, if this doesn't expand the individual range of choices, mm-hmm. I mean, it leaves us wage slaves by comparison.
Yeah.
Not to mention the part of our population that's working two jobs, or even three jobs in order to support people. And they consider that unconscionable. Unconscionable. No, to be poor in the Scandinavian countries, you have to work at it. You have to figure out how to slip through the safety net in order to be poor. You have to be like really determined. Because they don't believe in poverty. They say poverty is so 19th century. So 19th century, why would you want to do poverty? If you're interested in poverty, read Oliver Twist or, you know, read Dickens. We don't have to have actual poverty in order for you to learn about poverty. Well, or go to the United States.
Yeah, go to the United States.
About there. You know, but we don't have to have poverty because it's totally uncivilized to have poverty in a country that has any kind of decent economy at all. And, of course, all this time that they were developing these features of their society, the United States was much wealthier than they were.
Mm-hmm.
Much wealthier than they were.
So the money is going somewhere.
They chose to use their smaller amount of wealth mm-hmm. in such a way as to build the common good. And we chose to use our greater wealth to make more billionaires and millionaires. What a choice.
Well, it's really about ideology, isn't it? It's about...
It is.
We terrify, I mean, the some of the
democracy, and it's also willingness to stand up and fight for what you want.
Right.
That's what I learned in the civil rights movement, right?
Mm-hmm.
White people are not going to give you desegregation because you smile at something. They are going to do it because you fight for it. Mm-hmm. And that's the same way today. We are not going to get the Green New Deal by thinking it's a nice idea.
Right.
We're only going to get it if we fight. And the economic elite will pull out police power in order to put us down. Of course they will. They've done that before in the 30s, which was a period of time when Americans were standing up in mass numbers.
Mm-hmm.
They did, of course, put us down, tried to put us down. Many places succeeded in putting us down. With calling out troops and National Guard and that kind of thing. It's happened. Harry Truman called out the National Guard in order to put down the steelworker strike and under his presidency and so on. We know that when you stand up for yourself, there will be retribution from those who love the way things are.
Right.
But that is the nature of progress. We'd still have King George running our country if we hadn't been willing to stand up and fight. So I am very much in the American revolutionary tradition. It's just that I know that there's a better way to operate through nonviolence than way, way better than using armed struggle.
Right. Wow. It really is. I remember in Reading walking down the street, about 10 of us, with signs protesting the war or something, and some kids across the street said, "Are you allowed to do that?" I mean, talk about disempowered. We have terrified people so that they, you know, they think that all this talk about free speech, well, yes, there's free speech for rich people, but us people, no free speech.
And, right.
So that's really, so somehow or other, I mean, what impresses me about what you've done is your emphasis on strategy. That's what, and organizing, and that, well, I don't know what the problem is with why it's so difficult for some of us, but it is just figuring out, okay, what is a, as you said, you know, the peace movement, well, we're working towards peace, we're working towards the abolition of nukes. That is a completely unattainable goal by a small group of people in Berks County. However, it's true that, we could have attainable goals. It's just figuring out where the pressure points are and how to do it. And but you in your workshops, you teach this kind of thing, right? Obviously.
That's right. That's right. I invented a new workshop to go with my new book, which is How We Win. Because so many
one
people
up
who were reading, oh, yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Oh, that's it. Wrong way.
Yeah. Yeah, that came out, a lot of that came out of the feedback to Viking Economics, because people who were reading that were saying, George, so what if we want to do that? How do we get strategic about it? How do we use our energy to our best advantage? Right. Some of us have abundant energy, some of us have not so much energy. We'd like to use it to the best advantage. What is that? And so I wrote How We Win in order to explain this technology called nonviolent direct action campaigning, and how open it is to people's participation, whether they've got a little bit of energy or a little more or a little more. You know, we have different amounts of energy at different ages, or we have commitments to family or to work or something. So we have different things that we can contribute. The question is, how can we all pitch in such a way as to be able to create a sustained campaign that over time can go after a target and force that target to give what we want. And an example from our own recent group, recent past, is the PNC Bank, and I think there are PNC banks in Reading. Mm-hmm. The PNC Bank Corporation was investing in blowing up mountains in Appalachia.
Yeah.
For coal. So it's outrageous for the environment, right?
Yeah.
Dirty fossil fuels, so on and so on. And outrageous for nature, and also twice the birth rates, for twice the cancer rates for people in those areas, and birth defects up and so on. So it was a health problem, it was a problem in so many ways. And the number one financer of mountaintop removal coal mining was PNC Bank.
Really?
So we went to the leadership of the bank and we said, we're coming after you unless you give that up. Well, you know, this is the seventh largest bank in the country. we're this handful of Quakers. Quakers aren't that scary anyway. And certainly not to the seventh largest bank in the country. They said, ha. And we forced them out of the business. It took 5 years. I tell about that in the various writings, including in this book. We learned a lot in the process of doing it. And the things that we learned about how to force a mighty bank out of doing an awful thing, those lessons are in this new book, How We Win.
Have you got like a top three things that you learned in the course of that battle? Because it seems, you know, tremendous victory over enormous odds.
It was enormous odds. One thing that helps is if I don't know if this is going to add up to three, but one thing is it helps to have a goal, a demand that you think you can win.
And that demand was?
You never know for sure. But we thought we could win that demand for a couple of reasons that they give up financing mountaintop removal coal mining. One reason we thought that was because coal is on its way out anyway as a fuel source.
Yeah.
So we weren't attacking a coal practice at its height in terms of need, you know. So that was one consideration. Another consideration was that a bank has multiple places where it can be attacked. Right? I mean, there are branches all over the place, right? So that meant people anywhere in America that wanted to join us would have a PNC bank, or most places in America would have a PNC bank, and we would need to coach them about ways to do that. So we thought, well, that's a lot like the lunch counter sit-ins. I mean, a brilliant thing about the civil rights movement in 1960 going into lunch counters was that there were lunch counters everywhere. So you go into your lunch counter in Reading, and we in Philadelphia learned from that, and we said, well, we can do that too. And then we give it too, and so on and so on. So it can be contagious. So we thought that was a real advantage. And then I guess those were two of the big reasons why we thought that we could win, but we also knew it was going to be very tough.
I just wanted to touch on something else which struck me when I was reading about you and about the things you've done, because it brings up images of Charlottesville and fascists and anti-fascists. And you you talked about a demonstration in Clark Park where, you know, the fascist forces came in to disrupt, hoping to get that violence against them so that when I'm standing on the bridge, someone can shout out of the window, "Antifa, they're the fascists!" You know, and it makes your head swim. How on earth did that happen? but perhaps you could talk to that about using your brains when you're demonstrating or something.
Well, I'm of course, you know, deeply committed against fascism,
right?
And that was, in fact, reinforced for me when I lived in Norway and talked to people who had lived under a Nazi government. Because during World War II, the Germans came in and occupied Norway and set up a Nazi government. And it's just such a foul, foul, foul system. And there are Americans, and have always been, or for a long time, have wanted to live in a fascist country.
George,
and here we are, with their agitating.
We only have 3 minutes, so... If you could do this quickly.
So it's really important, whether we're dealing with fascists or anything else, to ask, what are they looking for now? Okay, the Proud Boys tell us that they're going to come to the city center. What are they looking for? What they're looking for is attention. Mm-hmm. They're looking for attention, if that's what they're looking for, which is likely. If they're looking for attention, let's not give them attention.
Right.
So that's one of the, I've had a national, I was on a national debate with the author of a book, Antifa, and I kept saying to him, look, you don't want to play the game of the bully. And we all have a lot of cyber experience in schoolyards with bullies. When we figure out what a bully wants, then the thing is not to give it to him.
Right.
Or else you reward their bullying. Mm-hmm. And in that way, fascism is like bullying. It's if you give them what they want, they'll just keep feeding on it. And grow and grow and grow, and tell stories when you're out of sight about how they played you. Mm-hmm. Let's not be manipulated, say I.
And persuade their followers that it's really these rough, tough Antifa who are the bad guys, and us with our regalia are the good guys. Anyway.
That was a fun article. Could I mention it was on wagingnonviolence.org?
Right. Now, wagingnonviolence.org, is it your website, or is it?
I'm a columnist. It's an online publication. I'm a columnist on it.
Wagingnonviolence.org. And it's got a whole bunch. I looked at it. It's very interesting on all sorts of issues. Every issue we can imagine. Let's just end on the Sunrise Movement, because not that I'm part of it, I'm energized by their presence. I'm energized to see young people standing up. And I assume, I know you are too.
Oh, very much so. And I'm also proud of them, because it was when I was a professor at Swarthmore that the students who then later organized and led the Sunrise Movement came. In fact, they learned about campaigning from the courses I was teaching. And we've stayed in touch ever since. In fact, I have Sunrise Movement people on my third floor as we speak. So I still try to keep track of them, even though I'm 81 years old and they're a movement of under 30s.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, they stop at the stairs, you know, and they say, hey, do you have a minute? I have a question. Yeah, very inspiring group, very, very inspiring group. And everywhere I go on book tour, I cross the nation multiple times in book tour. When I do author events, there are Sunrise people. It's growing very, very rapidly. And they're, of course, their thing is green new job, a green
new deal.
Green new deal, and they're the ones who lifted that up and made that a buzz in Washington.
George, thank you very much for doing this. It's been a great pleasure for me, and I hope for our viewers. And I wish you the very best, and thanks for appearing on Centering on Peace.
Thanks for asking me. It's been fun for me. Thank you.
Good night, George. Thank you for watching. Good night. You're still there?
Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.